And it's time to get a hold of the President, David Chartrand, of the Manitoba Métis Federation. And as usual, he's busy. He's busy.
How are you doing, Ray?
Pretty good. And yourself?
I'm at the Canada Inns down on Regent, not the casino one, past there. The Winnipeg Region meeting's taking place as we speak. And it's an excellent packed house. Of course, mm-hmm. you have the limitation of how much is allowed in the room. And then the others are going by Zoom and different formats to get their listen to what's going on in the region and what's happening across the province and hearing their leaders speak about the plans of their investment. So that's going very, very well. I had a chance to speak this morning, and I was very proud. I got a standing ovation and talked a little bit about our history, Ray, and gave acknowledgement to the forefathers who created our Constitution of the Federation and what it is today and how we've protected it and ensured that the identity of the Métis would never be stolen. And that our constitution is our constitution, and it's not for the government to decide how our constitution looks and acts. In fact, we're the only ones in the Métis homeland that have self-government agreement, and we're the only ones that keeps our constitution. The other three don't have self-government agreements, which they claim, and they have to change their constitutions to meet, they have to referendums and all kind of different things, and only for the internal governance is what that self-government is all about. Us, we're negotiating a modern-day treaty. It'll deal with taxation, services, programs, on and on and on. And we're already recognized as the government. So, and for the Red River, no matter where they live, they don't have to be in Manitoba. They can be in Saskatchewan, Alberta. All those listening out there to the Métis Hour can apply for a citizenship card as a Red River Métis. And you'll be welcome home to the Red River Métis and the Métis government. So, Ray, I'm telling you, we're getting thousands of applications coming from Western Canada. Mm-hmm. A lot of them want to come because they fear. Of course, what the Métis National Council has done, sold down their souls and sold down the identity of the Métis Nation. It's no longer the definition that was there. Ontario has actually shifted the definition to suit itself to bring in new people. And, you know, she tries to fool the people, President Froh, and I'll say her name publicly because that's a debate, this issue, any place, anywhere with her. Because she tries to fool the people by saying, you know, cause I look at her definitions, they're no longer the 2002 definition we all agreed to. And she fools them by saying the Pali Métis, Section 35 rights Métis, ancestry root Métis, and then historical Métis. Like, that's four different people she's talking about. Mm-hmm. And she tries to say that's the same people. They're not the same. And I said the simplicity of that is ask them, do they have the Red River card? Do they have the Métis Infinity Flag? You know, it was here in Manitoba in 1816 when it was unraveled, when we went our first battle. So did they have the Chif language? Mm-hmm. Did they have the prairie flower beadwork of all of our beadwork?
Yeah.
Did they have any of these things? I go on and on and on and on and on. And not one of them can attest or say, yeah, that's how we grew up. That's our culture. That's not their culture. The Algonquins and mixed with the Algonquin peoples mm-hmm. and the bloodline. So, but they're trying to steal the identity by calling themselves root ancestry or Section 35 rights or polys. You know, like that's what they're trying to fool the people in the West. But a lot of our citizens have heard this. They're not going to be fooled, and they're not going to let a bunch of people come and steal what we waited 205 years to get to. So as I said, they see us winning our hunting cases. We have hunting rights now, where child welfare legislation is coming, health legislation is coming, which means programs, services, potential benefits for prescriptions and medical supports and all the rest of it that's coming in our negotiation with Canada. So all these people in the eastern part of our country are saying, wow, I want a piece of that. I got mixed blood somehow. So that's the danger that's at stake here. And unfortunately, the president of Alberta, Patra, and President McCallum and Lisa Smith have supported Ontario. And they can claim they're saying, well, you're giving them a year to come back with more answers. Well, that's 10 years, 15 years we've been working for these guys to give them answers. And they keep on just shifting the titles and names. And they said, we're giving them a year to come back with a study. Well, stop and think about it. You're giving them a year. They're going to do a study based on their definition, not on ours as a national definition we all adopted. So if they did that, none of them would fit. You know, so, again, it's very clear. We know here in Manitoba, and that's what our assembly gives direction for. So we did withdraw from the Métis National Council. It no longer can speak or represent the Red River Métis or any of the Manitoba Métis Federation. And we will be speaking on behalf of our people nationally, internationally. And as I said, we're the only Métis nation with a government, a full-fledged government. So, mm-hmm. so as I said, and no boundaries attached to us. So the provincial boundaries don't apply to us. So I'll keep our people posted on that. But the cabinet's united, our assemblies are united, all the locals here that were at the Winnipeg region, the PAW, you name that region, Thompson region, everybody is unison on this. We're all in agreement. These people are not us, and we're never going to let them steal our identity. So again, Ray, there's only one race in Germain, for example. There's only one Métis Nation. So let's understand that. I want to start off by saying happy birthday to my godchild and my Gloria and I's godchild, Dr. Day Lily. I hope Al and Rita are listening. She celebrated her 10th birthday on Monday, September 27th. So that's our godchild. So I'll be spoiling her on going home for Thanksgiving. Mm-hmm. I got a commercial coming out on Thanksgiving. I know it's probably on our website only. We should put it on TV. So I think it's a damn good commercial. Anyways, I talk about our history and our culture about family and Thanksgiving and what it means to all of us, you know, and the smell of the turkey, the smell of the pies, and sometimes the bannock and the bread, and, you know, just the smell of the kitchen and everybody laughing and together, and, you know, time to not only wait to get together at a funeral or a wedding or, you know, come together and a dinner, for example, of this nature brings the family close again.
Right.
So as the oldest in our culture, they said in Métis culture, the oldest is responsible. And my job now, because I'm the oldest, my older brother and older sister passed, and other brother passed in 87, Alan. But I am the oldest of the family now, so we're having a turkey dinner in Duck Bay. I'm going, of course, to prepare all that. And I just love that part. Just, you know, just the laughter that's in the room, you know, and but the aroma. Oh, I just love the sitting there and visitors coming over. Right away, you prepare them a meal, you know. And you sit them down at the table, no matter who visits you, and you'll get a meal. So I just love that. So I know Robert Bushy, my late friend Robert Bushy, just loved this part of the season him too. He'll be cooking a storm, and as soon as you go to Robert's house and sit you down on the table, you got to eat. And that's the way it is. It's the whole cultural way, and I just love that.
Right.
Again, also want to say happy birthday to Diane Lavallee, October 5th. This is coming from her sister, April, and I think she has a party for her. I'm not sure. She does. It's supposed to be a surprise, but I'll tell her it's not a surprise no more. So they're having a birthday party for, I think it's her, younger. April's way older than that. So 34, yeah. So younger sister. And so I also want to say happy birthday to my godchild again, Marissa Sinclair, daughter of Francis and Charles, and celebrated her 30th birthday. And she's got her management certificate in childcare and so proud of her. And she bought her house and just proud of her. And so happy birthday, Marissa, and I hope she texted me and loved her presents we sent from my family to her. And also to Rose Boudreau. I want to say hi. You know Rose, of course, and Fifi is here at the meeting, Ray. That's why she's probably not calling you in. She's here, and she wanted to make sure she says hi to her mom. And of course, I told her I loved their song. I love the way she sings it personally. I heard Al DeJarle sing that same song. But I just love the way Rose sings it. It just makes it so natural, so real, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Not that I'm criticizing Al or any other singers. It just, when you hear somebody like with that voice and that granny singing a song, you know, this makes your heart warm up. So, Rose, I hope you're listening, and your daughter's saying hi to you. Dennis Ash, I want to say hi to you. He's recovering from gallbladder surgery out in as you heard me speak on the show, I believe I spoke last week on the water in Coal Lake in Sheridan. And Dennis Hatch was there to greet us and had to go for a gallbladder surgery right after I left, and wishing him well and healthy with speed recovery. I also want to thank the congratulations to Jack Park and the team at N4. They actually got an outstanding work safety culture award, outstanding achievement in making their workplace a healthier and safer place to be. So congratulations to Jack and the chairman of the N4 and the minister also of energy and infrastructure. Like, you know, N4 has done remarkable things. Like, we've been able to make deals with pipeline companies and others, hydro, and creating a vast amount of work. People don't realize you can't just hire somebody like that off the street unless they're certified, trained. I think we spent $150,000 training the team to get ready to all get the jobs and certification. So I was very proud of the many workers. 1 week to go and we'll be finished our project. And so I look forward to that. And so that's going to be a good one. Feather in our cap, we'll call it. And so that'll be going out to N4. I forgot to mention, I think we employed about 23 people are employed there in the pipeline.
Mm-hmm.
So I want to thank all those. But I guess to remind all of them, I want to thank John Swery, the minister, and the staff of our HRD, our MET program, because they put $150,000 ahead of time with N4 to train these individuals to get jobs there, because otherwise we could not hire them. So the focus for us at the N4 was to make sure that we hire Métis. We also hired some First Nation, which I'm very proud of, but I'm very, very focused on making sure that Métis people get jobs. And the focus, that was our focus. And there's a little bit of dispute there. Some of the employees were saying they wanted more money than they should be getting, and they got more when they worked up further north in Alberta. Well, you put those pipelines on your own, you get certified. Of course, they pay you lots for when you're traveling those great distances, and they have a bigger contract. Our contract, our main focus was getting jobs. That was our main problem. We're not there to make millions of dollars. We're there to make sure we get jobs for the people. So I hope they remember that later on as they go forward, because these jobs were because of the hard work of creating a partnership with the president of Enbridge. And that partnership still exists between me and the chairman. So that's very important, and we keep that relationship because there'll be better opportunities in the future. Also, I want to thank Elder Saints here this morning for giving an opening prayer, and, of course, Vice President Andrew Carrier and Dave Wadon and Joanne Remlar, the caucus for this region, and cabinet ministers, of course, at the same time. Dave Wadon is Minister of Agriculture and Associate Minister Joanne Remlar of Child and Family. But we had a very good discussion this morning about the future and where things are going and where locals need to go. I met some veterans here already, and they're just proud to be veterans of the military. One's a paratrooper, and he's just proud, and he wants to do his part. And I got Lillian Norman. I haven't seen her in ages, you know, so I'm so glad to see her. And I hope somebody tells her I was mentioning her name on the show, that she's downstairs. She won't be hearing me. But I haven't seen her in a long time. Lillian's always been a big supporter of mine. And it's great to see her out. And a typical Lillian, always trying to help somewhere. She came out and she said to me, "David, is there a way we can get more elders involved to help out anywhere, even the smallest things?" And I said, "That's a given. I'll guarantee you that. Minister Andrew will hear from me to get something organized in this region." Because when we started, for example, the beadwork that was being done downstairs, Lori Bockwell was still alive at the time. And when they started the beadwork, I thought it'd be 5 or 10 people under. And I walked in that room, there was at least 50 people beading. I was just shocked to see so many young, middle-aged, older, all doing the beadwork and learning the hearts of the Métis beadwork, right? And I was just so proud. And so to get our elders out there to teach our young generation and to tell us stories about who we are and not ever forgetting who we are. Because I talked about our struggles and hardships from 205 years ago to now. Like, these people are trying to steal our identity. I said to the elders here, they don't have a clue of what we went to hell and back. And we never shifted our position of who we are. We've always protected. Some had to hide it because of a domain of terror on them. And, you know, if they're white enough and spoke French, and then they say, "Oh, I'm French," you know, because if they said they're Métis, they'd be attacked. So they had no choice. The army was the military orange men that were left behind here were free to do whatever they wanted to families, burn their houses, you know, it didn't end there. 1930s, they burned St. Madeline down. So just in the southwest there. So the history of our people, that's so, so hard, that these people in eastern Canada and Ontario that are trying to steal identity, they don't have a clue what our people have gone through. So clearly I'll get the Métis veterans involved and also our elders involved, and we need their help. And they're the knowledge keepers of our future, and to remember our past, you know. You don't know where you come from. You don't know where the hell you're going. I'll tell you that right now. So anyways, I also want to stop for a second and pay tribute to all the orange T-shirts that actually participated in the walk on Portage Avenue. All the First Nations, non-Indigenous people, Métis, others that were there, all arm in arm, walking together to send a message that they matter and their history matters, and to understand what this country has done to them, and that it's going to take time to heal, and it's going to take time for us to understand it. But it's going to be important that Canadians remember this, not forgetting this. And I was so proud to see that. I reminded people here in my speech this morning, I said, you know, the residential school settlement, I said, it took place here in this country. I said, only about 5% pertains to us. The rest were all First Nation. And we got to bow our head to them. They went through such horror and hardship by so much numbers compared to us in the residential school. We got hit in the day schools, big time, you know, our population there. But that those day schools meant you could go home during the day, but it didn't stop people from abuse also. There was still abuse that took place. As I told my story, what happened to me with nuns up to grade 5, you know, how they whipped my wrist and then whipped the back of my calves if I spoke Soto.
I used to get that too.
Pardon me? You used to get that too? Yeah, that's what they did, trying to break the language and the culture from you, right? So, but, you know, I told our people, we have to pay homage to the First Nations, and I want to thank all of them that stood together this clear First Nation majority there, and I was just proud of them. I was very proud of them as a Métis leader, Indigenous leader, to see them that every child matters shirts they're wearing, and just a sea of orange. And you know what? I wish in solidarity that was taking place there was a solidarity that we had, and when it comes to politics, solidarity when it comes to how do we work together in natural resources, how do we work together in different segments of processes. Because government's so good at dividing our people, and others that come sneaking in there and making, like, jealousy is not part of our culture, not First Nations, not Métis culture. But now it's there. It's in our community. You know, some people are, you know, would phone on somebody, oh, that one's on welfare, what do they have a car in their yard for? You know, phone them, they got a car. You know, like, just unbelievable. Like, just how sad it's got when people have used things to hurt other people. And that's not our way. So I hope one day, as I've always preached as a leader, that we have treaties amongst our partnership with our First Nations, and that we can work together in harmony and understand each other's responsibility when it comes to natural resources, our environment, economic strengths, buying, supporting each other's businesses, things of that nature. You know, I look forward to that, and I hope one day it does come into reality, and we don't let outside forces divide us. So again, I send that message loud and clear, but I'm so proud of every one of them, both young, middle-aged, and old, that gathered together to walk in solidarity to remind Canadians that we matter. Indigenous people matter. First Nation people matter. Inuit people matter. Métis people matter. We matter. Right. And we're going to stand up to defend our people. So that was so, I don't know how to say how many times I can say over and over, so proud I was. My heart was flowing. And I listened to Trudeau that evening with that lady, I forgot her name now, First Nation lady. She told her story about when they took her and what she saw inside there, and the beating and the sexual abuse. And, you know, I told Gloria, you know, it's going to make me cry. You know, I was watching, and I saw how strong she was to tell a story and what she saw with her own eyes and she experienced, you know, like, and Trudeau, I could just see Trudeau's eyes and the way he was going through it. And, you know, and they pounded on Trudeau yesterday. And yet that's exactly what we said to all of our management, all of our people. Take the time to go spend with family. Go spend that time with family. And talk to your children, talk to your grandchildren. Remind them what this is all about. Because they're the ones that are hurting from all of this because of what the country did to us. But remind them what we're trying to do to overcome that one day. And that we need their support and their commitment to pursue education, to make sure they have responsibility in the future to carry their head proud on behalf of our nation. So that was our sentiments we sent out to our staff a few days ago, all of our management to take the day off. But the commitment we asked from every one of them, we got nearly 1,000 employees, is go spend time with your family. Take the time, talk to your kids. And that's what Trudeau did, but they attacked him. Now he should have been somewhere. They said, you can't be everywhere. But I was very proud of the Blackfoot elder that stood up for him and saying, no, he was there Wednesday night, and he's in his family. He's done so much for us. Why are we attacking him? You know, so, but right away he was attacked, and the media jumped all over it. So again, as I said, that's the negativity media pushes out, because that's what sells papers. It just sells news. And unfortunately, they don't write the good stories of all the stuff we're doing, housing we're buying, families are buying houses, and elders' houses are being repaired, daycare centers are being built, jobs are being created, child sports are being invested in, all these great things we're doing. You think they write a story on that? No, it's too positive. But if I said, oh, they stole money, oh, they'd be right there on the front page. You know, so
right.
It's just sad that somehow the society of media tries to depict negative stories versus the positive ones. You get the odd positive one, very odd. Anyways, as we all know now, this all cools off with this. We departed from the Métis National Council. We're no longer part of the Métis National Council. It is now a pan-Aboriginal organization. It's like Congress of Aboriginal People. It says it represents Métis Nation. It does not, because those are not Métis Nation in Ontario. I don't care how many different names they're going to give them, or they're going to disguise it or call it. They are not our people. They've never been our people. They're not connected to us. So MMF has given my assembly 3,000 people the unanimous, told me in 2019, if ever Ontario is brought back to the table and they're allowed to bring all those people in there, then you will withdraw from the Métis National Council. I listened to my assembly, and I've made clear that's our direction. In fact, on Alberta president said even at the Métis National Council Assembly, all four provinces took a statement in court that the General Assembly of the Métis National Council has no authority, has no purpose beyond giving some words of discussion. They have no authority to direct the Board of Governors mm-hmm. or the MNC or to remove or suspend anybody. That's their position in court. And Audrey even said it at that meeting, and nobody even stood up and said, wait a second, I'm an elected official here. I'm at the General Assembly. This right. General Assembly is supposed to mean something.
Right.
You know, no, nobody just, they just let it slide by. It tells you that a lot of people that need to be educated about their responsibilities, elected officials to defend their nation in the prairie. So they got a lot of work to do, I tell you, out in Saskatchewan and other places. These newly elected people, they better start understanding it. Because I tell you, next will be the funding will be cut from them. Other things will start to happen. The prairies will start to get a licking. Not Audrey, because Audrey will team up with the other two provinces. And they'll go Saskatchewan will licking. That's just a matter of when. What year, next year, the year after. Just a matter when Saskatchewan is going to get a hell of a beating from what they just bought into, that garbage of listening to Margaret Fro, that she's actually defending the Métis Nation, which she's not. She's defending, trying to steal our identity by bringing new people in. And she can disguise it all she wants, and it'll never succeed. Well, so, Ray, again, at the end of the day, I want to say to all our elders, thank you. To all the survivors, our friends, we stand with you. We're proud of you. And to all those young ones that ask yourself the question sometimes, what happened to my parents? How come they turned to alcohol? How come they went to drugs? How come their life is different than others? Stop and think as a young generation. The reason that their life is different because they went through hell and back, and they try to destroy your parents, your grandparents. They try to take the spirit away from them, and they lost their way. Now, a lot of them are finding their way home, and First Nations are doing a great job of promoting themselves on that, and I'm very proud. And the Métis Nation, of course, is doing everything in its power to promote its identity and protect its identity. We always will as a Métis government. We'll always have our people's back. So to all those young generations, be proud of your grandparents, your parents. They went through a hard time in life, and most of them are finding their way back. You will find your way there, too. So, again, be proud. Always be proud of who you are, whether you're Sioux, whether you're Ojibwe, or you're Cree, or whether you're Blackfoot, or you're Mohawk, and whether you're the Métis Nation of the Red River. Be proud of who you are. And so, again, let no one steal your identity. Take care, everybody, and be proud. Talk to you guys next Saturday.
All right. Thanks very much, David.
Yeah.
Have a good weekend.
Okay. Take care.
Oh, thank you.
And always remember, there's only one Ray St. Germain, and there's only one River Métis.
That makes me, oh, man, you made my day.
Okay, well, that's because I'm telling the truth, man. I don't bullshit. You know me.
That's right.
Okay, you take care, you guys.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, bye-bye.
David Chartrand, of course, the president of the Manitoba Métis Federation, in his weekly report, Métis Matters.